Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be back with NIAC again. Treat and I have known each other now 10 years, unbelievably. And I think, when was NIAC set up? Let's see.
2002.
Okay, so not long after he started the organization. And I admire so much what you do. As you know, the effort to support the JCPOA, to keep it from being blocked by Congress, took a lot of organizations and a lot of individuals, but I think you played a really, really important role, so you should be very proud of yourselves for the actions that you took. This is going to be a great panel. We're waiting for, let's see, one Sanam to get her mic on, and Djavad I saw earlier. Yeah, I'm waiting for my Persians. But why don't I begin by introducing them? I know you all probably know who they are and you have their biographies, but I'll just do a brief introduction and then we'll get started on the panel. Sanam Naraghi Anderlini is one of the world's most respected experts on gender and security. She's co-founder of the International Civil Society Action Network, a U.S.-based NGO dedicated to supporting civil society activism in peace and security in conflict-affected countries. For over a decade, she's been a leading international advocate, researcher. Sanam, come here if you would, right there, yeah. Trainer, writer on conflict prevention and peace building, working with women worldwide. In 2000, she was among civil society drafters of UN Security Council Resolution 1325 on women, peace, and security. Between 2002 and 2005, she directed the Women Waging Peace Policy Commission and led groundbreaking field research on women's contributions to conflict prevention, security, and peacemaking in 12 countries. Since 2005, she's been providing strategic guidance and training to key UN agencies, the UK government, and NGOs worldwide, including as lead consultant. Djavad, would you sit here, please, actually? Yeah, thanks. No, they've put my mic on this side, so I'm going to have to sit there. Thank you. Strategic guidance and training to key UN agencies, the UK government, and NGOs worldwide, including as lead consultant of a UNDP global initiative on gender, community, security, and social cohesion. And then we have the wonderful Hooman, Majd, who I think I first met in Tehran, probably when he was running around trying to help NBC, yeah? Oh, no, we met when President Hatemi came. That's when we first met, when President Hatemi was allowed to travel. You remember those days? before 2009, I think it was in 2006 when he made a tour of the United States. That's when we first met. But I'm most used to seeing Hooman running around in Tehran trying to help Ann Curry and various other people get interviews with senior Iranian officials. But as you know, he's also an author and a journalist in his own right. He's written for every important publication known to man, including Newsweek, The New Yorker, New York Times, New Republic, Los Angeles Times, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And he's the author of many books, The Ayatollah Begs to Differ, The Ayatollah's Democracy, and his last book, The Ministry of Guidance Invites You Not to Stay, which was published in 2013. Wonderful title. And last but definitely not least is another old friend, Djavad Salehi-Isfahani, a professor of economics at Virginia Tech and the Dubai Initiative Fellow at the Belfer Center for Science and International Affairs at Harvard's John F. Kennedy School of Government. He's focused much of his research on demographic economics, energy economics, the economies of Iran and the Middle East, and he's the author of four books, including After the Spring, Economic Transitions in the Arab World. And I must say he's been personally very helpful to me in my work at the Atlantic Council and has appeared at the Atlantic Council when we've had programs on the Iranian economy. So, without further ado. Slavin. I'm a senior fellow at the Atlantic Council, and I run a task force on Iran, and have been an Iranophile for 20 years.
Yeah, and so covered for USA Today USA for many Today years, and interviewed many of their
and various other publications and so on. So this is really going to be the guts of the whole topic, Iran in 10 years, where will we be? And I think I'll let each of our speakers perhaps talk for a couple of minutes, give their perspective on how they see the social trends in Iran, the economic trends in Iran, and the political trends in Iran, and what the impact of this nuclear deal may be on all of those. So Sanam, I'll let you go first, okay?
Thank you very much. It's lovely to be back with you all. Iran in 10 years' time. I think Alan Eyre said it. I have no idea at all. Having said that, I think everyone's going to be blonde, right? It's the entire country is going blonde right now. They have Angelina Jolie lips and Kim Kardashian cheeks, and the men are, it's extraordinary. So that for sure we're going to see. I think their babies are going to be born blonde as well, and we're done. We're going to beat Scandinavia. It's an interesting question, because to me what's special or maybe not special but is extraordinary about our society is that we are aspirational people. Where every single individual you meet, a taxi driver, an elevator attendant, the nurse, the insurance broker, people in the street, all want something better for themselves and for their kids. Right, so the elevator attendant is not happy for his child to be an elevator attendant. The kid is at university now. So by virtue of this demand for something better, I think that society is moving in a positive direction. Now, one of the questions that we had was, what about civil society? My observation is that civility in society has increased dramatically. I don't know how many of you have been back to Iran recently, but you don't hear horns on the streets anymore. People aren't honking, right? They're not shouting and being mad at each other. Somehow driving has improved. We drive within the lanes, and we know win-win. The cars come, but at some point they stop and pedestrians cross and so forth. In fact, it's slightly safer than walking in London, because I had my kids with me in London, and one of them nearly got run over because I was like, oh, the car will stop, and the car was really not going to stop. In Tehran, you don't get that anymore. So there's a certain level of civility that one sees emerging, and I recently sort of came across the term lifestyle movement, which was interesting, in the sense that people are just taking it on themselves to do and live their lives, and that's kind of how we are and how we operate. So that's a positive sort of forward projection or trajectory that I see. I see a lot of also issues, and I'm happy to kind of elaborate on them as we move forward. Thank you.
Okay, lifestyle changes. Hooman, now you've written some very interesting books about what life is really like in Iran. Maybe address a little bit, and I'll have Djavad look at the economic side of it, the political side of it. What we've seen in the aftermath of the nuclear deal being reached is a constriction, it seems, of civil freedoms. The politics looks even more complicated than ever. And one feels that, especially in the run-up to the parliamentary elections at the end of February, it's going to be very dicey politically. And I wonder if you share that view, and then if you could project out after that.
Sure. I do agree. I do share that view, that it's going to be dicey for a lot of reasons. President Rouhani was elected on a campaign to fix the economy. He said he couldn't fix the economy without fixing the nuclear issue and the sanctions getting lifted. He thought he was going to do it in a year. Actually, everybody thought he was going to do it in a year. We had two deadlines that got passed that we went by, and it took 2 years. So now that the deal's done, the implementation has to happen in order for him to be able to say, okay, I did actually do it. I would agree that there's a lot more civility because of this hope that that the aspirations that you were talking about are actually possible. I think in the years, certainly in the second half of Ahmadinejad's administration, there was a sense of hopelessness for any of us who went there. With young people, and you talk to any young person, whether they were from the lower, I shouldn't say lower, from the working classes or the elite, almost everybody, if they could get a visa, if they could find a job, they would prefer to leave Iran because there was a sense of, oh, nothing's going to change. And I think that went all the way right up to like a week before the election in 2013. So anyway, Rouhani decided, it appears, decided that there were a number of things he wanted to do to bring about change in Iran, because these are people who don't want to change the system, but understand that without change, the system itself won't survive. So the kinds of changes that he wants to bring about, he and his administration certainly don't think are a threat to the system, the Nizam, as they call it, as we all know. But there are people who do think it's a threat, including even this nuclear deal is a threat to the Nizam. Now, having done this nuclear deal, I think once it's implemented, once people, including some of those who are against the deal, see the benefits to Iran, I think that's when he has figured he can then attack the other issues. And the other issues are issues that are probably more important to the youth. And of course, we all know that Iran is a very young country, which are social freedoms, political freedoms, opportunities, the non-securitization of society. And that's his word. That's the word he used in his campaign. And you know, Khatami has used it and continues to use it. Now, Khatami is suffering from this securitization atmosphere, as are various people we know, including our colleague Jason Rezaian, who's still in jail. So that securitization will have to somehow be resolved. I certainly can't predict whether Rouhani will be successful. I think in this period between now and both the parliamentary and the Assembly of Experts election, which apparently, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think Rafsanjani has said he's going to run for the chairmanship again for the Assembly of Experts. He's 81 years old. So with those two elections coming up in February, I believe it is, I think it's going to be very, very dicey. And I think that that's just going to be, and because the implementation of the actual nuclear deal won't happen between now and then, although Rouhani can claim success here, he won't be able to show anything for what he has accomplished. In terms of 10 years, I think we have to think, I mean, that's a decade is a very long time in the Islamic Republic, mainly because if you looked at Iran 10 years ago and you look at Iran today, a decade wasn't so long. The leaders were all going to be in charge because they were all in their 60s or 50s. The leaders are all now in their 70s and 80s. So in 10 years from now, we expect many of them to be dead. In some cases, we welcome that. In other cases, we don't. And we welcome it only because we know they're going to a much better place. And free of the burdens of rule. When that happens, it's very difficult to predict what's going to happen. I think maybe Barbara, you were dealing with Iran at the time, from a journalist standpoint, the Khomeini to Khamenei changeover, and there were people who were, and people who remember that, it was a big unknown. And for many years after that changeover, we still used to call Rafsanjani the most powerful man in Iran. Today we don't. Rafsanjani, needless to say, will be in his 90s 10 years from now. We don't know. I mean, this is really an area where we don't have to be, there's no false modesty. It's really impossible to say who's going to be in charge. I mean, I would even say that the chances are good that someone like Mousavi will no longer be with us, who is under a house arrest today. He's old and he's ill. So let's hope that he's not under house arrest at that time. But I think it's just hard to say. What I can say is what I think, based on the people that I know are in the current reform movement and the moderates who are supported by them in the Iranian administration, is that their hope is they will have been able to move forward on many of the issues that I think Iranian Americans are very concerned about in this crowd, and the U.S. might be very concerned about. But with the region the way it is, with Syria, with Iraq, with the Israeli-Palestinian issue, I mean, sometimes you just want to give up. And I don't think, you know, unfortunately fortunately that's not an option. But, you know, to make a long story short, I think it's just we don't know.
Well, for what it's worth, a friend of mine just got back from Tehran and says the two most popular people in Iran right now are Javad Zarif and Qasem Soleimani. So make of that what you will. Javad, obviously the future of Iran and the nature of the system are going to depend a lot on what happens in the economy. As it was pointed out, Rouhani came in saying he would institute reforms. He's had some success in bringing down inflation, but problems of state control of the economy, corruption, and unknowns about how much foreign investment, particularly European investment, is really going to come into the country after sanctions are eased, I think those are big question marks out there. So why don't you take a stab at where the economy is now and where you might think it'll go?
Yeah, thank you very much. In fact, I think Alan Eyre mentioned, and a lot of people say, that the reason why the agreement was a success or the negotiations ended up with the agreement was because they focused on one thing. And Rouhani very much would like Iranians now to focus only on one thing, which is the economy, and not push this opening to the West into social and political area. And it's a big challenge for them to try to actually contain this, because expectations were very high in Iran at the time when the first negotiations started. People were talking about a direct flight to New York, and rumors about seats have been sold for next 3 years or something like that. So bringing down the expectations is very important. And having an economic policy that actually generates a few percent growth rates. I don't think anyone can be optimistic that Iran can do anything like China with 8% growth rate, no matter what level of foreign investment can come in. The reason being that one of the fears that the conservatives in Iran have is that a very fast, rapid growth, like we experienced for a few years in the middle of the 2000s, first decade of the 21st century, that it will open up all sorts of cans of worms of social and political issues, and they can't contain it. They think that they can deal with a 5% growth rate. That's enough to get people hopeful, some reduction in the unemployment pool and so on, but not so much that they lose control and that the private sector becomes the king, you know, and Tehran becomes the hub for airlines and for businessmen to come and go. There are, I don't think that anybody knows exactly how an 8% growth rate translates into social dislocation or political demands, but they're definitely afraid of that. So that's one of the reasons why you hear the Supreme Leader putting all of a sudden his foot on the brakes, as if he's trying to stop things, and sometimes overdoing it. So people get afraid and they say, oh, nothing is happening, and then something else happens. It's all because I think there's a lot of uncertainty there with respect to what level of economic growth they can tolerate. Iran certainly has the potential of having 8% growth rate. There's no question about that. Natural resources, the potential for foreign investment to enter Iran, and the manpower. I think Iran has a lot of educated, unemployed people, and also people, young people, whose expectations have been harshly dampened. A few years ago, they might not have wanted to have a job to compete with the Chinese workers in the global market, but I think a lot of them are now, they will take a low-paying job as long as it's a decent job, it's steady, and it's something they can bank on. They can get married, set up a home. So I think in some sense, if Rouhani can deliver that 5% growth rate, he would have fulfilled his promise beyond the agreement, because the agreement was just an instrument for jump-starting the economy. And I doubt very much there'll be a whole lot of foreign investment, because as you pointed out, there are the rule of law, as far as the economy is concerned, is quite weak, perhaps even weaker than it is in the realm of politics. There are powerful foundations that control things. I don't know how they will perceive the opening up of the economy that Rouhani has in mind. Whether he can bring them in and say, you can make as much money as everybody else is, so don't stand in the way of small businesses growing. I doubt very much that the public sector is rich enough for the IRGC, the Revolution Guard's economic arm, Khatam al-Anbiya, to want to play a very big role. When the budget was $20 billion, the development budget. This is a rich government in the mid, just five, 6 years ago. It's a rich government, and to stand next to the purse and make sure you get most of the money and not let anybody else get, that was a big deal. and they were willing to jump in, affect the politics to make sure that happens. But for the last 3-4 years, the development budget has been $5, $6, and then $10 billion. There's not a whole lot at stake. This is a government that doesn't have any money. So try to line up and put a lot of pressure and affect politics in a negative way to get 10% of that, which is $1 billion, I don't think is as big a game as before. So I have, you know, I am a bit optimistic that certainly the supreme leader should want that, should want to push these guys a little bit back, open up the space for Rouhani and for the private sector. The biggest news in Iran is the rise of the private sector. Everything that you see, rise of Rouhani, I don't think is because of young people wanting freedom and so on. I think he uses them in order to get elected. But the people behind him are the private sector. And that's not a bad thing, in my view. If you're an economist, you really want the private sector to become strong. The fact that they have organized in the Tehran Chamber of Commerce, in the Iran Chamber of Commerce, in various parts of the country, and put their money in one place to help Rouhani's campaign, and now they're still helping, trying to get his people elected in February to the parliament. I think that's testimony of Iran modernizing in some very deep sense, that people with money are interested in politics, not just rent-seeking, not just trying to get a buck and run away with it, buy a house in Canada. It is to affect the rules of the game inside Iran. So I think in some sense, I have a positive outlook for the next 10 years.
I'm going to ask you one follow-up, and then I'm going to go back to Sanam. The follow-up, you said you don't expect much foreign investment. What about China? Because China has managed to increase its stake in the Iranian economy over even during the period of sanctions. And the Chinese, many of their banks are less exposed to Western banks and so on. They don't have to worry about falling afoul of sanctions in the way perhaps that some European companies do. Do you think the Chinese are going to try to swoop in and invest, particularly in the oil and gas sector, and that the Iranian government would welcome that?
Yes, in the oil and gas sector, everybody wants to invest. But that's not, I think, what Iran needs. What Iran needs is to strengthen its human capital base. It needs a kind of investors who come and teach Iranians how to do things, how to produce. The Chinese are good at that. Unfortunately, they have a lot of their own people who do this kind of work. Mm-hmm. You know, in the place I call hometown, Naishabur in Iran, there is a Chinese factory. It's manned by 50 Chinese people. They don't hire any Iranians. They don't know how to get them to work. So in that sense, I don't think the Chinese are in the front row. I think the French, maybe the Germans, the Swedes, and these Europeans are more likely to come to Iran and hire Iranians and teach them how to do. As you know, the Chinese are already holding like $22 billion of Iran as collateral for the projects they're engaged in. So that means they're really trying to make sure they get money from Iranians, not moving capital into Iran, but making sure they get paid for whatever they do.
Okay, Sanam, let me come back to you, since you were very modest and spoke not very long. You talk about the importance of civil society. Yes, there are groups that are interested in things like the environment, for example. But what are the red lines? There has been a very powerful women's movement in Iran for years and years, yet many of its stars are right now occupying uncomfortable little cells in Evin prison.
This is the thing, that we don't have standard set red lines. The red lines move. It's a little bit like the staircases in the Harry Potter movies. You know, you're never quite sure where the red lines are. And I think that's really been one of the ways that's the system that we have. My father, who passed away recently, used to say that Iran is a system without a system within which a system operates. So if you quote him, it's, yeah. But I think all of us as Iranians understand that, right? It's there. And so the issue, if we talk about it in terms of the women's movements and so forth, you're right. In terms of organized activism and it is difficult, and I think it will continue to be difficult for lots of reasons. That there is a sense of what we call the hardliners or the del pasón, as they call them now, you know, being concerned about these types of issues. But if you look at it from a societal standpoint, right, if you take it away from organized civil society, NGOs and others, which is what we're used to here, and you take it out into the broader public and you look around, that sense of empowerment is has actually been it's kind of in the DNA now. You know, for me, it was, again, very interesting to see nurses, insurance brokers, you know, just ordinary people who are not necessarily politically active, but having a very strong sense of what their rights are, a sense of dignity about the fact that, you know, they're doing this work because it's their duty and believing in their own professionalism. This, I think, is phenomenal, right? It's not about one person or two people. It's about an ocean and it's a mindset, which is really, really critical. And I think that's a great thing. And it's not just elite in any way. I mean, it's all the way across society. The hard part of all of this, which I think is maybe the next stage of what we need to tackle, is that when the Iran deal was happening, one of the things that was interesting for me was that despite, for the vast majority of Iranians, right, outside of the country, as well as inside, despite all our political differences, the grievances that we had, a lot of legitimate grievances that people have had, we stood and we wanted something good for our homeland. It was almost as if a patriotism overtook political difference, right? Mm-hmm. This is an enormous step forward in our community. I can't tell you how important that is. And it's this sort of power that we really shouldn't be. We should embrace it, and we need to extend it, I think, to those who are worried, because there is a fear of an existential threat. In the same way that people here have had that, it exists on the other side amongst, what people would call hardliners and so forth. I think that we need to humanize the relationships. I think we need to have conversations with each other. You know, let's talk. Because the isolation has also created all sorts of other misperceptions amongst you. I mean, of them of us, but also them of the West. The number of people who would ask me questions like, you live in America, America's like this, and I'm like, no, trust me, your life quality of life in Iran is way better than my basic quality of life. I go to work, I come home, you know, I'm worried about my health insurance. Life is tough out here, right? You lose your job tomorrow. They don't understand what life is actually really about. And their perception, the irony is that you have the isolation that's been thrust on people, so they see it through the window of the internet or through really cruddy Turkish soap operas, and then they emulate that, right? As opposed to actually coming out and seeing that in this country, for example, it's a very religious country, right? I mean, they just, the isolation has backfired because they end up with a very bizarre sense of what the United States or the West is all about and what modernity is about and so forth. And I think, let them come, let them see, let us have conversations with each other about what it is that we want for our country and open up and not be fearful of each other. I think that's really the next stage of where we should be going as a community and as a society.
It's my hope that this kind of people-to-people contact will be allowed and will be facilitated. And here I worry about certain elements lurking in the shadows and not always in the shadows. But let me open up to your questions. If you would ask a question and say if it's directed to a specific individual, all the way in the back there, and wait for a microphone.
Hello. Hi, my name is David Curtis, and I'm a recent graduate of college. And so as a young Iranian-American, I'm kind of troubled with next year. It's kind of impossible for me to see myself ever kind of voting Republican because, like, I'm so desperate for Iranian relations to open up, you know, with America and just sort of this whole hostility to end. And so I guess my concern is, it happens on both sides, like Hillary saying she's proud of, having Iranians as her enemy. So, but if a Republican takes the White House next year, are we all screwed? And is the thing missed?
Hooman, I think you should answer that one.
Well, there's always Bernie. I mean, you know, I assume you vote in the primaries too. I don't know if we're all screwed. It depends. It depends very much. You know, I think you have to take Donald Trump at his word. You know, he's a businessman. No, I mean, listen, Donald Trump could win. Let's not. Ahmadinejad won in Iran. Why can't Donald Trump win here? I don't want him to win. I will vote against him, but it is possible. I actually don't think he's going to run all the way, but I think it's possible. And I think that a Republican president is not going to undo the nuclear deal. A Republican president is going to be probably as practical as Hillary Clinton will be with Iran. But I also agree. Well, listen, I mean, I think it's a practical issue. Alan talked about some of these issues. The Iranian U.S. relations are not going to change anytime soon. What I was saying earlier, about 10 years from now, with some of the people maybe on both sides no longer being with us, that things could change. But I honestly don't see a major change, whether it's a Democrat or a Republican in the White House. I don't think there will be an undoing of this relationship in terms of like a foreign minister of Iran, whether it's Zarif or the next foreign minister talking to Kerry or the next foreign minister. I don't think Hillary Clinton's going to prevent that or stop that. It's not in the interest of the United States, and it's not in the interest of Iran to stop any of that kind of communication. In terms of us as Iranian Americans, yourself in particular, you know, going to Iran, wanting to do business in Iran, wanting to perhaps buy property in Iran, that's always going to be tricky in the next few years, whether it's a Democrat or it's a Republican power. That's my view. I wish it weren't the case. I would agree that, you know, if we had some more dialogue between Iranians and Americans, it would be much better. And as Barbara pointed out, you know, for Americans to travel to Iran, which I think is becoming easier for tourists, tourists.
Sure, and others who are not hyphenated.
Not hyphenated, yes. Iranian Americans are particularly, targeted. But the only thing I would disagree with is the Delva Passan, who I think are just basically evil people, and I prefer not to have dialogue with them because their dialogue, I mean, they're just not willing to understand at all. So that's my personal view. Yeah.
If I could add something, if this will comfort you, at the Atlantic Council, we pride ourselves on bipartisanship, and we've had a number of private events over the summer. We had private dinners with Ernie Moniz, the energy secretary who played such a huge role in these negotiations. And I had a lot of senior Republicans come up to me afterwards and say they were in support of the agreement, but they couldn't say so publicly because it would hurt Jeb Bush, or it would hurt this one, or it would hurt that one. A lot of them were advising some of the Republican presidential candidates. So I think there is actually a sensible center, certainly among the Republican policy types who populate Washington, and that they just cannot say these things openly during the campaign. But we did have Brent Scowcroft, we had Dick Lugar, John Warner, people like that who came out publicly in support of the JCPOA, which was great. Yes, this lady here. Wait for the mic.
This is actually for you, Barbara. You were saying that some of the Republicans were telling you that they were in support of the agreement, but that they couldn't say it because they didn't want. Has anyone ever said that they didn't really think that there was a nuclear program at all, that this is used really as a pretext, as a red herring, in order to contain Iran, since the Mossad has said over and over again that there is no nuclear program, since that our own intelligence services said that after 2003 that they
you
kind
mean,
of
weapons
like
weapons program.
Weapons program, exactly. Okay. The weapons program, that this whole weapons program is just like a pretext in order to contain the influence of Iran. Have you ever heard that?
That's very conspiratorial. Alas, alack, Iran has had a real nuclear weapons program, and certainly until 2003. After that, most people believe that they've continued research that would be of use to them if they ever wanted to build nuclear weapons, and that what they are now is frankly a nuclear threshold state. If they want it, they can have it. But what I always say is that it's the slowest moving proliferation program in the history of man, because as you all may know, the program started under the Shah. Eisenhower gave Iran its first nuclear reactor. And in that span of time, China, Israel, India, Pakistan, and North Korea have all developed nuclear weapons, and Iran has not. So if it wanted it so much, I think it would have gotten there. But they definitely had a program. they definitely have the knowledge and the expertise, and that's why these negotiations were so important. It wasn't just a pretext. I don't know if anybody wants to jump in on that. All the way back there, the lady with the hand up. Yeah. I'll come to you.
Thank you for being here. I have a question for you that I've asked many different people, including Michael Oren and some Iranian scholars in Washington, and I've gotten completely different answers on it, so I was hoping maybe you guys could clear it up for me. So it might be a little naive or ambitious to say, but my question is, do you think the United States and Iran could ever bond over their common enemy that is developing in the Middle East, that is ISIS? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, putting into perspective, my enemy's enemy is my friend, whereas Henry Kissinger's offered that in the Middle East, my enemy's enemy is still my enemy. Do you think that the United States and Iran could ever, even if it's covert or secret, could ever work together to combat ISIS?
Do you want to grab that?
They've already been doing stuff in Iraq. I mean, I don't think it's even secret that there has been coordination between the Iranians and the Americans in Iraq. The problem, from my perspective, and I work across the region in terms of the ISIS story, is that you know, we also have Saudi Arabia, and Saudi Arabia is a country that in this last year. Every other day they've beheaded somebody publicly and they want to crucify someone and they're bombing Yemen. And we as America are actually supporting their efforts. And Saudi Wahhabi philosophy or ideology and ISIS ideology is not so different in terms of what they propagate. So and when I go to Guantanamo, please send me cookies. But the issue is that as long as that alliance is there, and as long as Washington, and it, again, behind the scene, people will talk about these issues, right? And they'll talk about these genuine grievances. But as long as you have that issue of saying Saudi is our best ally, Saudi, you know, along with Israel, but it's really difficult to unbreak and I think untangle some of these issues. And we can talk at length about Saudi, Iran, all this kinds of stuff, but certainly around ISIS, we've seen active. You know, there's been some coordination of effort, at least in Iraq, in the public news reports.
You have a question right here, lady right in front here.
Thank you for a brilliant panel. My question is for Dr. Salehi-Isfahani. I'm Lily Sarafan, serve on the NIAC board. A few weeks ago, I had the opportunity to meet with President Rouhani and his cabinet during the UN General Assembly with a group of business leaders. Someone in the room asked, with all the rhetoric of death to America, death to Israel, with the lack of respect for intellectual property, how do you ever expect for there to be foreign investment? He addressed the question in part, but then said, during the 80s, before this, you know, terrifying sanctions regime, there was significant foreign investment, and this rhetoric still existed. If anything, it was worse. So who do you agree with, and what do you think is the one barrier that we could address to significantly improve the situation for foreigners to be comfortable with investing in Iran?
Well, thank you very much for that question. Let me start by saying that I think it's a mistake to see this agreement as one between Iran and the United States, or to see most of its implications in that bilateral relationship. It's primarily an agreement to free up Iran's economy from sanctions and link it more to Europe and to countries like Malaysia and Brazil and India than to the United States. And I think part of the reason is that Iranian businessmen, especially smaller ones, are quite unhappy with their experience with the Chinese. And they have almost no experience with the United States, very, very limited, because the United States has not been trading with Iran or investing for 30 years, since the hostage crisis, 35 years. Whereas Europeans have been very active. If you go to, again, my city in Iran, almost every factory that's there has something from Germany, from Denmark, you know, England, and they're all complaining. They're almost waiting for this relationship to happen, because they show you their stuff and they say, yeah, we used to get this from Germany. It was really nice and clean. Now we get the same stuff from China. Sometimes you find dead mice inside. I don't know if it's a cultural thing. They feel comfortable going to Germany because they have cousins and so on. Mm. Or is it genuine better relationship in terms of finance, trust, you know, and delivery and so on? So I think if we do not overburden this relationship with making sure that it does more than it's capable of doing, improve human rights in Iran, you know, improve relationship with the US and so on, it can do what it's, what Rouhani, I think, wants it to do, which is to bring foreign investment. That foreign investment in Iran, these are people who have relationships from the past. Sure. You know, I know a guy, for example, who went and bought a secondhand factory to make powdered milk, right? He knows those people. And this death to America or abuse of human rights in Iran don't necessarily impact that relationship because it's personal. They know what can be done. Money does go back and forth. And that level of trust at the level of business, I think, is really important. And that exists between Iranians and Europeans, and to some extent with Indians, and maybe even Brazilian, Malaysians, and so on. Relationship between Iran and India has improved a lot more than with any other country, because Indians were basically saying, look, we don't have any money to give you now. By the way, Americans don't let us to give the money. So they would have taken oil and would not pay back. Now they're respecting contracts. They are beginning to treat Iranians like partners. And so I think foreign investment is not the biggest, the biggest thing that can happen. We, Iranians, businessmen, lose about 10 to 30% on just trying to launder the money around the globe, right? So if you think of just getting back to getting banking relations right, so they can move the money and they can buy, they can LCs and so on, you already have, you know, Iran just a couple of years ago imported $70 billion. You know, 20% of that is a lot of money. So before foreign investment can come, this is going to kick in. And trust is going to rebuild between Iranian businessmen and businessmen across the globe, maybe even in the US. US businessmen can do stuff with Iran. All they have to do is to set up something in Italy and you know, and trade that way. Foreign investment is not what I would put my money on right now. Technology is very important, but I think they need not bring the money. Iran is not that poor. Once it begins to sell more oil, it can buy technology. If it has access to the global markets, it can buy it. It doesn't need, it's not that poor that needs foreigners to bring money and technology together.
Okay. Gentleman right here in the front. Wait for the microphone, please.
Thank you. My question is to Mr. Majd. Do you see the grip of this IRGC and the security establishment ever weakening? Because you could envision a situation where the Supreme Leader goes to better world, and then the successor is elected or chosen or forced by this establishment. So what kind of conditions? I mean, I know it's an easy question to answer. So what kind of conditions do you see where Rouhani could loosen the grip of this establishment?
Yeah, it's a good question, and the answer is I don't know. But we can guess. I think the security establishment in Iran is not just the IRGC, but the general people who are concerned with security in Iran and internal security particularly. I think when it's in their interest, they tend to back off. And when it's shown to be in their interest, they tend to back off. There were times during the Ahmadinejad administration when they didn't feel threatened, when all centers of power in Iran, all the executive branch, judiciary, parliament, everything was in the control of the conservatives comfortably, before Ahmadinejad went on his big sulk and started, you know, saying nasty things about the Supreme Leader. Before that, there was a time when there wasn't as much of a securitization. There was, yes, of course, there were political prisoners. It was post-2009 and all that, but it was still didn't feel as oppressive as it does even today, 2 years after Rouhani. So I think it's when they don't feel threatened when they feel it's in their interest. So I think right now they're feeling it's very much, they feel very much threatened. They feel very much threatened by Rouhani when he says particular things like, oh, I don't believe in the censorship of the internet, or I don't believe in, you know, political prisoners, and Khatami says things like that. That scares the shit out of them because it means taking control away from them. But I think that they can be persuaded. Let's put it this way. I think they can be persuaded. I mean, let's not forget this IRGC that is the bogeyman of every Iranian, particularly outside of Iran, is the same IRGC who voted in the same statistical numbers for Khatami twice. Over 70% of the IRGC voted for Khatami. This Qasem Soleimani, who you mentioned, Barbara, who is the most popular man other than Javad Zarif, yeah, who has, now has a bust of him. I don't know if you saw
it's
that.
It's horrible. He looks like Vladimir Lenin.
I know. I'm surprised they allowed that to happen. But anyway, but the Qasem Soleimani worked very closely with Khatami and the reformists. I mean, these are liberal reformists like Khatami. Khatami told me once, and I think I mentioned it in one of my books, that when Afghanistan was liberated from the Taliban, that Soleimani was the man he trusted to give him weekly briefings as opposed to the Iranian ambassador in Afghanistan. So I think the IRGC is not quite the bogeyman that we think of it. I think there's elements in the IRGC who are quite scary, who are afraid of losing control and will crack down when they need to crack down. But many of us may have had experiences with, as an example, the morality police, which is part of that whole securitization thing. And when you talk to them, some of them are just like, you know, man, I just got a job to do, leave me alone. You know, tell your wife to put her, you know, damn headscarf up a little higher and leave me alone. So I think it's just like, you know, I don't think everybody's doing it out of ideology. I think there's a certain amount of political will there that needs to be broken. And I think that depending on how strong Rouhani, assuming that he wins re-election in 2 years, how strong and how forceful he can be. I mean, he is very much a politician in a way that Khatami wasn't. So I think there's a little bit of hope that although he's not quite as liberal as Khatami or not quite the philosopher king that we kind of would like to see in Iran, he's a little bit more, you know, Iranians don't mind Machiavelli. They kind of like Machiavellian princes if they can bring about the change that they want. And I think Rouhani kind of fits that profile.
Okay, so many people. Right here, okay. Thank you. Wait for the microphone. No, wait for the mic.
Yeah, any of the panelists can answer this question if they like. My question is really, as a complimentary question to the earlier question regarding United States and Iran relationship. And I think one of the problem is that Iran's good behavior in the past has not been rewarded. And you just brought up the Afghanistan issue, and as we know, Iran played a very important role in Afghanistan and Iraq. During Khatami's administration. But unfortunately, as we know, George Bush dropped the ball and didn't reward, you know, Iran the way it should have. And I think that's a big problem in building for the future relationship, and that's probably one of the reasons Iran is so hesitant to move fast on. I'd just like to know if you make a comment on that.
I wrote a book about it. definitely the axis of evil, all of that did not help. But I think another concern, and this goes back to the economy, again, a friend who was just in Tehran came back, said that there's a real fear that U.S. will do something to prevent the Europeans and the others from coming back into Iran, even though, you know, the nuclear agreement, we've promised to implement it. And I would say that my concerns there reside with the Treasury Department and their very, very strict interpretation of U.S. sanctions. That's a concern, because the people who are in charge at OFAC and all the way up through what they call the Department of Terrorist Finance and, are the same people who've been there for 10, 15 years, and they have an animosity toward Iran that's not based on the nuclear issue, but that's based primarily on Iran's attitude toward Israel. And so, you know, if it's a very strict constructionist interpretation of these sanctions, the sanctions easing, and if a lot of European banks in particular are spooked about going back in, that's my concern, that that could begin to sour the atmosphere and we could lose yet another opportunity. And there, I think, who becomes the next president of the United States is very important, and what their attitude may be in regards to sanctions. For what it's worth, I don't know if anybody else wants to add on to that.
You know, I wanted to come back to somebody said, you know, when you look around Iran, what's going on, and then the Hillary Clinton comment and so forth. And what gets me is that we're constantly talking about the past, right? And we need to look at the present. And the American government, whether or the Republicans and the Democrats, also need to look at that region and understand what's going on. That you have Afghanistan falling apart, Pakistan pretty messy, Iraq, Syria. I mean, it's World War III out there, guys. I mean, it's nasty and it's spreading. It's spreading all over the place. And then you have this one country, it has all sorts of problems. We understand, you know, there's all these issues that we have. But there's stability and there is a moderate society there. And at some point, we have to sort of say, okay, are we going to engage and think that this is a useful place for us to engage with? Or are we going to try and bomb it to hell and then have the whole, I mean, imagine Pakistan with its nuclear weapons being able to, you know, go through Iran. I mean, it's a bulwark there. And I, as I say, for all the issues that we have with the politics and all the things that are going on and all the things that Hooman was saying, I think it's really... it's important also to sort of take a step back and think, where are we now? And that trajectory of the region doesn't look good in the next 10 years. It really is pretty bad as far as, it's kind of depressing. And our country is the only place where I'm like, there's a glimmer of hope. So can we enable something positive to come out of it? And coming back to your point about, you know, these guys, that's what I'm saying. It's that we can't demonize every single person. There's a vast, vast majority of people who are part of the IRGC who are just there, right? And coming to the visa issue, if you served in the Sepah, you don't get an American visa. That's it. I mean, that would be an interesting policy to change. That just because some kid, age 18, was recruited into the Sepah by the
time...
Or volunteer, or no, but even if they were sort of shipped.
You're drafted. Well, you can choose which one, but the SEPA is better because you get up at noon instead of getting
right, right. Or they want smarter kids or whatever, right?
No, it's getting up at noon. Yeah. They say, you can stay in all
you know,
for the
rest of their lives, they don't have access to, you know, I mean, so these are just some of the tweaks that should be made to enable that kind of exchange and not demonize an entire segment of our society.
Oh. And if we're going to have strategic conversations with Iran about the problems in the region, it would really help to have some people from the goods force there, since they're the ones who are on the ground implementing the policy.
Yeah, but I think what Barbara said, just one point, I think, you know, you mentioned Israel, and I think it is a huge, huge elephant in the room. Always when it comes to U.S., particularly U.S.-Iranian relations. And I don't think that's going to go away because Iran, the only time it sort of became a baby elephant was in the Khatami years, where there wasn't rhetoric so much. And then Ahmadinejad brought up the Holocaust and the wiping Israel off the map. And from then on, the Iranian conservatives and especially the hardliners have felt a need almost to continue to say, yes, we are going to wipe Israel off the map. And no, we're really not sure if the Holocaust happened. So, I mean, this is something
that's
going
to... Yeah, they do it deliberately to prevent
to prevent the relationship with the United States. It's been a really convenient thing. They learned from Ahmadinejad that they could actually do that.
Yeah. Gentlemen, all the way back there in the Czech shirt, if you wait for the mic.
Salam John, this question from you. What is our responsibility as an Iranian American to bring the unity so we can practice that in the rest of the world and Iran? What is my responsibility?
I think we have to act where we are, right? So part of it is acting within our own community in the U.S. You know, one of the things for me is, you know, if you're an Iranian American, if we asked you certain questions, let's do a survey, right? Did you want war with Iran? Do you want sanctions to affect the population? I mean, if you answer no to those questions, you should be a member of NIAC, right? Because NIAC is doing it. Instead,
Instead, it's we have this thing that this group is political and this group is this, and it's nonsense. I mean, we are all, you know, we should be reaching out to those who, you know, maybe people don't want to be members of groups, but you don't need to. We don't need to undermine each other. We're not team players. Let's put it that way, right? Iranians, generally speaking, are not team players. We're learning, and it's about time for us to come together and have either collective efforts or the strategic partnerships, but not to chuck each other down when somebody stands up, because nobody else is going to do this for us, right? And so that's, at least here, let's do that. On the Hillary Clinton, my kids are 14 years old. Every time a politician says something stupid or bigoted about Iranians, I'm on Twitter kind of making fun of, I mean, I ask them, what do you think? And they give me really smart, savvy comments, 140 characters, and I put it down there because they're better than I am. But it's important for us to speak out. I don't care if Hillary Clinton's going to become president. I do not think that it's right for the president of the United States to demonize an entire population thank you. It's, you know, so here I have I have rights and I have responsibilities, and I take it as my responsibility to use my voice, as long as I have it, to speak out for the little pieces of it that relate to me and the people that I care about. And as I say, the Iranian community is one thing. I work in the Middle East, and I bring those voices out as well. But at least let's try and do that amongst ourselves. Thank you. Right here.
This is a question for Mr. Majd. No one has talked about the judiciary in Iran, and that seems to be the other elephant in the room. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, it's an elephant in the room because it's controlled by the supreme leader, who has chosen to use the judiciary where convenient to challenge the executive branch. But it's no different from any other aspect of the Islamic Republic. I don't think the judiciary will follow what the supreme leader wants for Iran up until now, because he appoints the head of the judiciary. So I don't know that it's an elephant in the room so much as it is just part and parcel of the Islamic Republic's constitution the way it is now. And going back to what I said much earlier about 10 years from now, we don't know if the Constitution will be exactly what it is today. We don't know if the Supreme Leader will be more of a constitutional Supreme Leader as opposed to an executive Supreme Leader. That's certainly the preference of some of the Ayatollahs, that the Supreme Leader should not quite be from the quietest school of Shia Islam, but certainly shouldn't have an executive role the way he does. There are mullahs in Iran that you can go and speak to in Qom who will tell you that they think this kind of velayat-e-faqih, this way it's conceived, is actually going to be the death of Shia Islam. There are people who will say that. I'm not saying they're going to be the winners in a battle for the supreme leadership, but I'm saying we don't know exactly what that's going to be. And whatever that's going to be is going to probably control the judiciary. I don't know. In the early days of the revolution, the executive branch was also the head of the army, was a commander, was a commander-in-chief. The president was the commander-in-chief. That changed. So these things, we really don't know. I don't know it's so much of an elephant in the room as it is today, right now, what Iranian-Americans are concerned about, relations, business, for example, talking about Iranian-Americans. They want to do business with Iran, and why shouldn't they? There's all these tremendously successful Iranians in America, entrepreneurs, people who've grown up here or have immigrated here, who could do business with Iran and understand the culture, have family in some cases in Iran, and are going to be prevented, and they're going to have some Chinese and English company doing business and people doing business in Iran. I mean, what can we do to change that? I don't know. Vote for the right president or the right congressman. I don't know. Or talk to your congressman and say, why is Airbus selling all these planes? Why isn't Boeing doing that? I'm sure there's some Iranians who work at Boeing.
Boeing is allowed.
Yeah,
and the question should be addressed to Boeing. Why aren't you trying?
Why is Airbus getting these contracts now? So, I mean, I don't think, but the Israel thing is a problem, because what it does is it makes people like Hillary say things like that, even if she doesn't mean it. I don't. First of all, by the way, I don't think Hillary meant the Iranian people. She meant the Iranian leadership, but it came out as the Iranian people, or Iran in general.
But I think it makes the Israel question makes her say things like that, and will make other politicians say things like that. Hillary, when she was, I'm from New York, when she was running for senator in New York, she apologized for kissing Yasser Arafat's wife. So let's not forget how tied in this question of support for Israel, or at least, if not support directly for Israel, for the Likud party, support for not another war with Israel is,
In the middle, Julia, yeah. Wait for the mic. Here comes the lady with the red dress. Good.
Okay, I have a question. Oh, to follow up, Barbara, you said it so eloquently. I really commend you, because I have heard the Treasury Department also speak very strongly about the sanctions issue and how this is only about nuclear-related sanctions, that U.S. companies should not think about engaging with Iran. Even me as an American, not of an Iranian descent, I worry about going to Iran because the message is don't touch it. And so my question really is, if Treasury is so strongly trying to keep this messaging that sanctions are not coming off, and then congressional sanctions remain. Do you think that since the deal that Iran struck was really on their side about sanctions removal, if this doesn't go forward to the extent that Iran really wants it to go forward, then does the deal fall apart? Is this?
No, Alan Ayer, I don't know if he's still here somewhere. Where are you, Alan? He said it very well earlier. I don't know if you've all read the JCPOA. It's long, and everything is specified in it, and the Iranians knew exactly what they were getting. They were getting the lifting of so-called secondary sanctions, the sanctions that impede foreigners from doing business in Iran. They knew that they were not going to get lifting of American sanctions, except for in a couple of areas. It says, for example, in black and white, that Boeing can sell civilian airliners to Iran. And we've also already had an exception for humanitarian trade, food and medicine and so on. That's allowed to go forward. So I don't think so, no. My concern is that Iran won't see as much of a benefit as it might otherwise have, because even though it's allowed, Europeans will be nervous that, there's something called a snapback provision for sanctions. So, if Iran is caught violating the deal, the sanctions are supposed to snap back. So, will European companies, European banks in particular, say, let's stay away from this for a while and sort of see how it goes and make sure that, Iran implements before we go forward. And I defer maybe to Djavad. You said that Iran is a rich country, that it wouldn't necessarily need all that foreign investment. What's your sense of whether this animosity toward Iran on the part of the U.S. Treasury in particular, whether that's going to prevent Iran from achieving the 5% growth that you said was optimal?
I don't think it will prevent the modest growth, because the oil sanctions are being removed. So Iran will be able to sell more oil. Even at current prices, that would be enough money to get these dormant development projects. There are hundreds of them across the country. To jumpstart those, you bring Europeans. Optimism rises. Some Iranians are going to go back with their money, with their human capital. I think 5%, by the way, is modest, but it does a lot of stuff. Iran has right now, if you use the international norms for defining a middle class, which is about $10, $11 per person per day, 60% of Iranians are middle class, according to that criterion. It's one of the largest middle class populations in the Middle East. Very similar to Turkey. 10 years of 5% growth rate will take Iran to 85% middle class. That's going to change the mood. And I think it will affect things in the U.S. as well, because what we call Iranian behavior is not just how the leaders behave. It's also the behavior of the people that influences the behavior of everyone on top. Because these people, by the way, they have uncles in the Revolution Guards. They have son-in-law here and there. They're all connected. When you go actually to a small town, that's one of the benefits of going to a small town, is everything looks kind of ridiculous about these Revolutionary Guards, because there is no Revolutionary Guards who doesn't have a reformist close cousin. Or who has or knows who's gone to school with a businessman who wants a good environment. So if you just imagine the stories that you hear in Washington, like Revolutionary Guards are going to go stop these small businessmen. These small businessmen will just look at the guy and say, are you kidding? You know, you come with your guns here and you want to arrest some of my employees to create a crisis because they didn't have the hijab right or something, because you want to shut down because I'm competing with you, because you want to, your other cousin is going to open a factory. You know, these are the kind of things people worry about. In a small town, this wouldn't happen, because these people are connected. Iran has changed quite a bit. Let me tell you, if I may, just for a couple of minutes, because Nishapur is actually a very interesting city. It has a now a governor who was offered to become governor of a whole province. He turned it down. He said, I want to go to this town, to this city, because I see potential there. And the potential is quite amazing, because he was defeated when he went on for the parliament a few years ago. And I remember telling him that during Ahmadinejad, he was very optimistic, but he got defeated. He went to Tehran, he's back. He sees a very changed city. And the representation of that was on the Khayyam's birthday. They brought a lot of people to an auditorium like this, about the same size. And you had people with ties who were being presented with prizes. One of them is a well-known physician from Switzerland who has Nishaburi heritage, Professor Sadiq. Another one is a famous Armenian composer. There were two of these MPs, parliamentarians from the city, who hated this governor of the city, who defeated him, who are belonged to all these scary groups, right? They went on the stage to give the presents to these guys. So I asked him afterwards, the governor says, how did you do that? He said, you see, they looked around the room and they figured that they need these people's votes. So they had a choice. They could stay in their seats, boycott the meeting, or they could come here, get the votes in February. They gambled that the vote's more important than whatever rabid people can pull out of a election box. So this dynamism there, I think, is really very, very interesting. The more people are not worried about their daily lives, who can count on a $10 per day or $11 per day, according to my calculation, if they become 85%, these small cities are going to be very, very different places. And I think Americans in Washington eventually are going to see that.
Mm-hmm. Please.
You know, we talk a lot about foreign investment into Iran. What I'm interested in is Iranian products coming into the West. I mean, think all, we have amazing food products, amazing quality of just what I saw, for example, date vinegar. It's much nicer than balsamic vinegar. I mentioned this yesterday to someone. I mean, there's a lot of really high quality materials and products there that should be coming outwards, which would create jobs there for Iranian companies and for Iran. So thinking about it that way, I think, would also be kind of interesting, because, you know, we need it to be both ways, and we have a lot of good stuff. So maybe that goes back to your, you know.
I would add artwork to that.
Yeah, art, exactly.
And jewelry,
yeah. Exactly.
And clothing.
We used to produce the best silk and velvet. I mean, yeah. You know.
I also just want to add one very quick thing in response to your question. We shouldn't be forgotten that the Iranian leadership, and this includes the reformists, really don't care that much about doing business with America. It's just the rest of the world. It's the SWIFT banking system. It's the oil. They haven't done business with America for 35 years. One of the reasons they wanted to do business with America was because of aircraft, basically. I mean, you know, you had Porsches, you had Maserati setting up a dealership before these SWIFT things and all these sanctions came in. So they were doing business with everybody in the world. Yes, they wouldn't mind having Camaros back in Tehran, but you know what? They'll take the Porsche. The rich kids of Tehran will take the Porsche instead. The reason the airline thing was so bad was because they couldn't even buy Airbuses. Because even throughout the Khatami years, they couldn't buy Airbuses, because 10% of an Airbus has American parts, and so America could tell them, you can't buy it. So that's the reason. So really, it's not that big a deal for the Iranians.
I think American products are still very popular. Well, anything that has an American brand name, but they can get that through Dubai, or they can get it from Europe.
Yeah, so. And by the way, Samsung refrigerators now are just as almost as good.
Men in the orange shirt, right? Better actually, but
they're better, Samsung. Because we don't make anything in America anymore. That's the reason.
I am sorry. I am a Frenchman, which is the worst nationality to have after the negotiation. And we have been living quite a long time in Iran. I was in Iran during the Shah time for a few 2 years. And then after that, in 91, I went and stayed a long time in Iran. And we have a good knowledge of your country. Not of all the country, because it is a huge country, but we know deeply people from different level, social level. We didn't go. The last time we were there in 2010, and then we went back in this year twice.
Okay.
My first reaction is, I have never seen ever such a huge social difference in Iran. Money is flowing from north of Tehran or Shimiran down to the center of the city, but further back, further south, people are poor, very poor, and you have an explosive economic situation.
Okay, let me stop you there. Djavad, inequality, income inequality, how bad is it?
It's actually not bad at all compared to Turkey, for example. It's the Gini coefficient, this is how we measure inequality, is lower in Iran than it is in Turkey and in most Arab countries. It's about the same as Egypt, but Egypt is a much poorer country. Very poor countries tend to have more equal distributions of income. It's interesting you mentioned north and south. This is true. Northern Tehran is a very, very strange place. These are people with incomes, average incomes of $100,000 and above. I can't afford stuff there. I live in northern Tehran when I go, but I go to grocery stores and I look like a poor man. I am asking how much this, how much that, because things are expensive. But these people have so much money. But they are 0.01% of the population. When you go to south of Tehran, you no longer see people living in cardboard houses. There are little parks almost everywhere. Iran has, in one respect, it has succeeded, is delivered what it could on populism, which is to equalize living standards in terms of access to electricity, to water, to health, even to natural gas. Every household in Tehran has natural gas, poor or rich. This is a very different story than you find in other Middle Eastern countries. I think there is something to the populism of the regime, which is to deliver stuff equally across the space in all cities. So I dispute that there's that kind of inequality that's socially explosive. It is true that Iranians demand more equality than Turks do, because it's a distributive society. You know, nobody in Iran talks about productivity. Everybody's talking about somebody else who stole the money, I didn't get it. This is a very explosive situation, and Rouhani has to convince people that, first of all, there isn't a whole lot that's stolen. Very hard to do when every other week there is a $3 billion stolen pot of money or a lost oil rig. But first he has to convince that the game isn't all that rigged, that hard work pays. And then you will see that Iranians will come to trust the game, the capitalist game, much more. By the way, another thing that people forget is that Iran has always been a capitalist country. It never became a socialist or anything like China. Private sector has just been either pressed hard down or has been up. It's the level of socialization of capital is quite limited. People talk about Iranian government owning 80% of the capital stock or employment. That's not true. The proportion of people who work for the government has reversed, just like the rural-urban that Alan Ehr mentioned. It used to be 30-70, and now it's 70-30. Average Iranian works for a private sector firm. And all those things, I think, tells me that the public policy in Iran has become really critical. That's one of the biggest bottlenecks. Foreign investment is important, but knowing what to do with the money, because the economy is complex, these issues about employment, about the banking system, they require expertise. If I were going to pick one thing from the United States and take to Iran, it wouldn't be Boeing parts. It would be economists from the Kennedy School.
Trita, do we have time for one more, Trita?
Sure.
One more question. Ah, gosh. All right, the man over there has been very patient, so let me bring it. Well, wait for the microphone. Be patient one more second.
Back to the nuclear deal, sure. And speaking of economy, Dr. Salehi alluded that $20 billion of Iranian money has been kept in China, and presumably that will be released after the nuclear deal has been reached. Is there any hard number, say plus or minus $10 billion, that the total money that has been kept due to the sanction, we hear anywhere between $50 billion to some even say they go as far as $200 billion, you know. So in the Joint Plan of Action documents, has there been any numbers?
The administration has said $59 billion, but has said a lot of that is committed to, you know, as in China, previous projects and so on. I don't know, Djavad, have you heard anything else?
Central Bank did something. I don't know if you trust their numbers. They came up with $29 billion. And I think that's probably a good ballpark. 50 is a number that I hear a lot. 100 certainly out of the range. There's a lot of cash inside Iran. There's a lot of gold inside Iran. So Iran has reserves of maybe $80 billion already, outside and inside and so on. And I think if you are pushing it, if the Chinese money is not really part of the sanctions. It is deals they made with Iran. They say, if you want us to do this, we are going to keep $1 billion of the money that we owe you for that project. It's just a way of getting, because they don't trust the Iranians to deliver. And they didn't trust because Iran was under sanctions. Nobody would trust Iran when it's under sanctions. So they tried to, so that's why Iranian credit was so bad. Everybody was taking, it's like you couldn't borrow to build a house because you had to have full collateral for everything.
Okay. Unfortunately, we are out of time, but I think our guests will hang around and talk to all of you. Thank you so much for your questions, and thank you very much for coming.